Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
To start. Hi, my name is Andres Monroy. I'm a researcher in Fuse Labs. And today I have the honor to introduce Luis Blackaller. He's an art director at Wemo Labs. And he's also a lecturer at USC. And he's going to be talking about some of the different projects he's been working on connected to social computing and art. So with that, please.
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank Andres for inviting me to come here and have this conversation with you. I think we're going to have a great time. I planned this talk a little bit as in more of a lecture format, but since we are not that many and the space is relatively small, let's try to, like, if you want to turn it into more of a conversation, I'm willing to do that and, like, stop and chat about things that might raise questions or would require clarification or whatever. That said, I'm going to start by talking a little bit about me. My name is Luis Blackaller. I was born in Mexico City, and I met Andres in the MIT Media Lab, where we were both graduate students. I currently live in Los Angeles, where I work as an art director and user experience designer in a digital creative studio called Wemo Lab. Prior to the Media Lab, I spent more than a decade working in film and making art. I come from a traditional visual arts and visual storytelling background, and this has greatly influenced my relationship with technology. Let me explain a little bit about art for a minute. In the frame of traditional arts, the work of art is thought of as a static object that is meant to be passively absorbed by its audience. A painting, a book, a photograph, a movie are all good examples of this kind of art. During the course of the 20th century, a lot of things happened that gradually changed this. And I think there is a parallelism with concepts that emerged through the development of what we now call digital media, information theory, and cybernetics are both examples of these kind of ideas. I was able to experience these changes over the course of my own artistic practice. There was a time when I was preparing a presentation for the evaluation committee of a scholarship I had, and the final product was going to be this, which is graphical installation made with assembling a bunch of aluminum modules that had like prints in them. So I made a little scale cardboard model for this and I went to see the committee. And while I was showing them how I was planning to assemble this, I suddenly realized the members of the committee were more interested in coming up with their own configurations and their own designs than the design I was trying to show them. This raised a number of very interesting questions to me. To what degree was authorship shared if I chose one of their configurations over mine? What if I changed my design to present the final piece as a configurable object that people would then assemble in the gallery or the museum where it was shown? This interactive feature would definitely improve engagement, but I am not completely sure, even to this day, that this engagement would be more meaningful than the actual contemplation. I mean, was there any space for reflection after the configuration time was over? This story of art in the 20th century has dealt with a lot of similar questions. Let's go over a few famous examples. Here is the oldest one in my list, which is not that old, but you know. Here is Art as Action, and this is Pablo Picasso drawing with light. these drawings do not exist in the material form. They were captured by a photograph. Here we have Jackson Pollock working in his studio in 1950. To Pollock, and this is something that he couldn't stress more, the process of making the piece was as important as the finished piece. If you didn't understand what he went through to put together his piece, you didn't really understand or have a chance to really understand the final art. Artist program. Solovitz, wall drawing number 65, first executed in 1971, National Gallery of Art, Washington. This one is from 2004. So Solovitz basically would write little programs, basically, that people would then execute in different locations. And to him, the art was in these sets of rules or programs rather than the result. So he could give you a sheet of paper that said, find a white wall, get a set of four color pencils, the red, green, blue, and yellow, for example, and then start making lines following a simple principle, like make the first one in more or less what you think is the center of the wall, and then start trying to cross them until, in a certain way, until you finally cover the whole wall, which is more or less what happens here. It's definitely an interesting idea that the art are the rules as opposed to the actual painting.
How did people get the task? Do they have a piece of paper?
Yeah. This is part of a conceptual art movement that Solovitz was actually leading, and he would just write them down and form teams and have these teams make the art. One piece that I really love of his, it's probably my favorite one. You require a whiteboard like this, and the first rule is make a line as straight as you can with your bare hand through the center of the whiteboard. Then change colors and just follow the line as closely as you can on the bottom. And keep doing that until you reach the bottom and then start up. And the resulting image is always fascinating, because by the time you're here, I'm not going to do that because I'm going to bore you to death. But by the time you're here, you have these crazy landscapes, and the colors just kind of flow very nice. This one is easy to find on the internet just by looking at images through his name. This is art as computation. This is the first of my examples that actually shows digital technology in it. And this is from Vera Molnar in 1988. How to remove the racks from the hinges is the title. Well, the title is in French, but I won't dare pronounce that. She actually thinks of the computer as an extension of her drawing process. She is actually drawing with the machine instead of his hands, which is also an interesting take that took a number of artists in a different direction. Then art as interaction. Myron Kruger's Small Planet, from Seagraph in 1993. In this work, you are controlling the navigation through a computer-generated 3D landscape just by moving like an airplane, like children do. This is a very important example because Myron Kruger was very convinced that having the audience and the art object in a relationship together, he believed that the art happened just in between them, that the art was the interaction between them. So this is a very important idea that defined a lot of what many other artists pursued later on. Then art as communication or telematics. Roy Ascott, Aspects of Gaia from 1989. This piece featured a number of network installations across the world, and users were able to experience remote changes made by others in real time. So if I was in Mexico City and you guys were here and somebody moved something here, I could see that like change in the configuration back there. It was in 87 when Simon Nora and Alan Mink coined the term telematics to describe something, the new electronic technology, to describe the new electronic technology derived from the convergence of computers and communication systems. To me, this is really funny because I've always thought of like the digital medium, I've always thought of it as essentially communication, not necessarily computation first, but communication first. But this reminds me that there was a time when computers were not so deeply intertwined with communication systems like they are now, and they were looked at more as a computation tool, right? They are still that, but for us, it's very hard to think about them without the communication component attached to them. Art as participation. This is from Rafael Lozano Emer, a very active artist that actually just opened something very nice in New York City. Relational Architecture 4, Vectorial Elevation. This is from Mexico City in the new year between 1999 and 2000, the Y2K year. Vectorial Elevation is an interactive artwork designed to transform the Zocalo Square in Mexico City. A website allowed people to control 18 robotic searchlights located around the plaza, and a web page was made for each participant with photos from three webcams. This piece was unplugged in January 2000 after receiving around 800,000 visits from all over the world and Mexico City. And art as personalization. Golan Levin and Zachary Lieberman Reface Portrait Sequencer, 2007. The art is the performed process that results from the construction of a recombined self-image. This is also another example of another very important idea, which is having the capacity to interact with the audience in these new different ways. One possibility that emerges is that the members of the audience effectively become a part of the art. So here this participant is putting her face in the art. So the art is her in a way, which is it's a very empowering and a very interesting idea. How are we doing so far? Anybody wants to ask something? Okay. So all these examples diverge from the traditional idea of art as a static object in at least one thing, reinforcing the importance of at least one of these concepts. Process, interaction, emergence, communication, and participation. From all the examples we just saw, one of them deserves special attention. Roy Ascott was as interested in art theory as he was in art practice. Over time, he developed what he describes as the five characteristics of contemporary art. Now this, when I read through it, it's gonna sound very, kind of like, it's a little obscure, I guess, the language, but if we think through what these words mean, we will realize they are actually fairly simple concepts. And these five characteristics are connectivity between the parts and persons, which means network communication between the piece of art and all the members that are interacting with it, users or audience, whichever way you want to call them. Immersion into the whole, thus dissolving subject, frame, and ground. That means kind of taking the art out of the frame and embedding it in the environment. Interaction as the very form of art, just as Myron Kruger used to say, transforming art from a behavior of forms to a form of behavior. And transformation or process as the perpetual flux of image, surface, and identity. This is just an ever-changing piece of art, right? Some transformative element to it. And finally, emergence, which is a perpetual realization of ever-changing, unexpected meaning. This we know very well about what happens when we build simple systems that end up showing complex behaviors that were not expected or part of the design. These five characteristics can easily be said to describe digital media and, in extension, digital art.
But this applies to anything that is contemporary art, right? It's not only digital.
Yeah, he was talking about contemporary art. The thing is, the funny, an interesting thing about this is like when all this discussion was happening in the late 80s, there was no parallel discussion trying to talk about what digital art is. Even now, it's a relatively obscure topic in the realm of art theory. And there's, if you start researching about it, there's digital art and computational art and communication art and new media art and all these things kind of like overlap in places, but don't really answer the question of what is it and what is an art that is digital? What is the characteristic of this medium that could make things different? Well, what is it actually, you know? What is digital art? And that's a funny thing, because the traditional idea that a work of art is a static object has actually managed to influence the perception of digital art outside of the art world in pretty much that way. To prove my point, let's look at what a couple of search queries for images on the internet will reveal. And this is what Bing gives us. Interesting blue palette, which is funny. And this is what Google gives us, with also a blue hue over it. That's just a random accident, right? But like, what we can see here is that there's a lot of 3D and there's a lot of Photoshop, right? Here, in these images, the digital medium is used as crutches to help produce things that could have been made without computers anyway, just in an easier way. When we go to Wikipedia, even here, digital art is treated as an art object. At least Wikipedia does go a step further and treats digital art as art that is made with digital technology to talk about digital technology. So it starts featuring these kind of installations where like, this is kind of like experimental prints, and these computers have a library of images in them that are encrypted, so nobody can see them, but the images are actually there. So it's a statement about like, what is this kind of thing, very conceptual, but it's still just an object that you go and see, right? And think about. There's nothing wrong with that. And it is actually behind the scenes. In the way computers are and the web are used to share, distribute, and remix these images and their elements, that the digital medium realizes its true potential, where tools and platforms become a new canvas. When I joined the Media Lab, that was me right there, I was obsessed with the idea of tools, digital tools, programming magical pencils that make musical dancing drawings and, you know, things like that. I didn't get the social system aspect of a digital network as an artistic playground yet, like this kind of shift from formal to social and from tool to platform. Luckily enough, one of the specialties of the research group I joined, the physical language workshop, was precisely that. And one of my first assignments was to join the design and development team of a project called OpenStudio. The purpose of OpenStudio was to combine an online social network with a creative arts economy. Upon sign up, new users would receive a starter's amount of virtual currency. And it was up to them to build a relationship with the community by purchasing art, selling art, making art, or transforming purchased art using the tools provided by the OpenStudio system. Art was made using a SVG-like vector drawing standard called SMPL. And because of this, art was treated by the system as code, making its digital nature evident. Every modification was versioned, even after duplication and transactions occurred, kind of like forking on GitHub. And it was possible to track the evolution of every part of a drawing all the way from its conception to its incorporation in any other piece of art. The social graph was defined through commerce. Two users were connected only if one of them purchased art from the other. And every user was able to modify and remix any part of anything they made or purchased as long as the original creator authorized further modification of their art through embedded Creative Commons attribution schema. There was no support for direct communication between users. no wall, no chat, no inbox. No, to communicate directly, users would need to do it through their own art. Here's the homepage of this system. It featured a new art feed, and there's also a feed for recent transactions, galleries, prices. Here's my profile picture from that system. This is recent art. This is a job summary management thing where you can see the jobs I'm working on for someone else and the jobs that I contracted from someone else. There is a list of people that are showing my art. After that comes a list of people whose art I'm showing. And there's a gallery space and a portfolio space and the job space. The difference between the gallery and the portfolio is basically that the portfolio is where I show things that I made, and the gallery is where I show stuff that anybody else could have made. It featured numerous open views for historic data, including account status and history. This was kind of like an experiment that we tried to make, which was all the financial data from every user was open to everyone else. So we were just trying to think about what would happen in a financial system where all the finances are just disclosed to the public. Provenance from the original author of the drawing, going all the way up to all the transformations. And this could be rendered as a tree because, you know, there could be duplications and there could be like pieces that are taken and used in something else. And also history of the transformations of the piece itself. There was also a tag system, which we called that artsonomy, which was not just a classification system. It also meant, it was also a means to socially commenting on the work. When tagging a piece, users were shown which other members tagged similarly, and these tags bubbled up to the tag cloud of each user. You can see there's tags that I get on the pieces I create, tags that I get on the pieces I collect, and tags I use to comment on other people's art. This is a job offer page where like the user Raquel is requesting from me a specific commission that is gonna pay three. The name of this virtual currency was Burak, three Buraks, and the description of what the work was, and then whether I decide to continue with this task or not. And this is a timeline that we attached to the tag cloud at that time. We wanted to see how trends were like bubbling up or disappearing. Over the course of a few months, we can see how like cute became more important than bloody, which is pretty funny. Talking about emergent behavior, some users started making frame-by-frame animations. The funny thing about this is that if you were to do this, the way you're making the animation is, it's not really a function that the system has. It's something that the user discovered that if you quickly draw the sequence of frames of a particular animation and then you just hover over the feed, you will see the preview of those images being replaced by each other and then, you know, performing the animation. But all this guy needed for someone else to ruin this animation is that somebody just saved another drawing halfway between the process of producing these two, for example. So it's this resulting state of a homepage is just a lucky accident.
How long did it last?
This? Oh, well, it just gets pulled down, right? It actually stayed that way. This user managed to get their little chunk of the timestamp for these drawings is all in sequence, so they were just saved that way. Mm-hmm. Now let's talk about a much more simpler system. The Tiny Icon Factory is an anonymous aggregation tool for making 3x13 pixel black and white icons. This is a 30 times enlargement of that. The drawing tool is so limited that it became extremely easy to use. Anybody could create content in a few seconds with this. We decided to keep the barrier of entry as low as possible by allowing users to publish in anonymity. This is the JSON data object for one of these icons. I actually formatted the string a little bit because, you know, in the real object, it would just be a single string of zeros and ones. But by splitting up into 13 character long strings, we can show, and this is something that we were trying to do a lot at the time, have like a sort of a transparency correlation between the data and the generated image that it was representing. So like, if you actually squint here, you will see that the drawing will come back because the zeros are black and the ones are white. So it's just that. And it had all this other data. We were tracking, again, the evolution of the piece through its history. You could be able to load one of these, edit it, and resave it. And we would know where it came from, and things like that. Uh-huh. This is the front page. We also learned that anonymity will turn your website into a bathroom wall pretty quickly. That's just the way things are. But we have a pretty pretty cool and very simple search API and everything. If you go to the website and click on the search link, you will see instructions about how to build very simple URLs that will return you images or JSON objects or things that correspond to that query, like love or heart or swastika.
But people have to tag them, right?
Yeah, they have to be tagged. They don't tag too much, but the ones that tag, funny thing is there's a relationship between the ones that are tagged and the ones that are duplicated for some reason. And so people duplicate more tagged than non-tagged icons. Probably the people that tag them are more careful about making them, I don't know. In terms of production volume, the Tiny Icon Factory became by far the most successful project I worked on, collecting hundreds of thousands of icons. Invested Power users, again, started making frame-by-frame animations, and some of them figured out that they could write in reverse and started messaging each other. Of course, there was no user model here, no sense of identity. There was no way to know where the things come from, who were they attributed to. There was no real user component to this. But it always amazes me the amount of time that people get to put when they like a system like that. And like those animations, there's tons of them. It's just crazy. Mm-hmm. I got a little lost. Yeah, okay. PictureXS is another one of these systems. It's a picture aggregator similar in spirit to the Tiny Icon Factory. It featured anonymous posting, tags, anonymous commenting, an embedded tracing tool, a user-based censorship system, and search by average color in addition to the default tag search. It had collected around 40 to 45,000 images before it was turned off in January of 2010. This website lived in the Media Lab servers. I wanted to take it out, but I still can't afford hosting it on my own. I would have to come up with a way to make money off it and then put it in there, so like whatever. So this is the homepage, and again, it's a very simple experience. This is how a picture looks like in a pictures page. Once you activate the tracing tool, the tracing tool acted in a similar way as OpenStudio in the sense that like every time you used it, it was a different layer, though it was presented to the user as a flattened object in the end. Here is the censorship system and the hexadecimal average color thing, which was pretty fun.
So people censor areas of the photo?
Yeah. You would like basically drag along and you could like enter whatever text you wanted. That was funny. A comparative analysis between PictureXS and the Tiny Icon Factory reveals some interesting insights about creativity and participation. We were interested to know if there was a relationship between posting versus browsing, or how many of the visitors to these websites were active versus passive. And that's very easy to calculate just by roughly calculating the ratio between visits versus posts every day. And it was not surprising to realize that these both systems basically exhibited opposite behaviors over time. If you think about it, the Tiny Icon Factory offers a pretty simple and pretty rewarding creation experience. You just go there in a few seconds, you made something, and it's there. And it's kind of cute, but it's also funny, and it's like you could make 10 of them in 1 minute. It's just toon, 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 right? Looking through them, however, is, I mean, they are kind of small, and they are kind of plain looking, and there's a ton of them, so like browsing through them doesn't feel to me that is the more relevant aspect of this experience. On the PictureXS website, on the other hand, it's a huge collection of pictures, rich in visual content, that is very well organized to be searched through. So like if you wanted to look at robots, you could look at robots for a while and then whatever. And adding content to it, it's an experience that doesn't add anything to you. It's just you have to go and choose what picture to upload, and then uploading it's just like anywhere else. And on top of all that, there's no user model, so there's no way you can actually claim authorship to your post. You can't really say, look, I posted this cool picture. It's just another cool picture appeared, and nobody knows where it came from. So there's, I don't think there's enough of a reward to make it more relevant to post than to just browse. How are we doing so far? Anybody wants to say something, add, ask, comments?
With the picture one, I didn't get exactly what it is. So you upload a photo and then you draw on top of it, right?
That's not part of the core flow. The core flow is just to upload. The drawing on top of it was an addition that we made later, just to see if people would like scribble through it. And it was not very successful in that regard. Most of the add-on flows were, the only thing you would have to do is upload and tag. That would happen at the same time. And the rest, you would actually have to kind of like know your way through the tool to do it. Yeah?
How did you guys attract users to these services?
Well, usually, very heuristically, kind of like we were part of a research lab, so the first thing we do is, hey, we just have this, so like help us promote it. And then all the people in the lab would get the URL and start using it and send it to their friends. And then, you know, we would blog about it, and we would send it to our friends and family, and we would tweet about it when, I mean, some of this stuff is even before we knew Twitter existed, which is funny. So it was like pretty organic. There was no real strategy about how to do that yet. Anyone else wants to say something?
Well, I sort of have a question about these systems. Is they're very limited in the design space, and trying to remember, there's a game designer who made a stupid Facebook game called Poke a Cow, and basically, or Click a Cow, you click on it, and then six hours later, you can click on it again. And he wrote about the amazing things people did with this stupid system that was intentionally designed to be frustrating and limited. And he said that was more of like an indication of people's creativity when faced with something that's so limited and boring and stupid. And it's more of an indication that the creativity of people rather than that it's a good system. And so I was wondering your response, because these projects are very, very limited in their scope, yet you get amazing variety and amazing content out of that, where people figure out that you can make animations or actually post messages to each other. So I wonder if like this sort of emergent behavior is, were you expecting any of that, or like, what can you say about the system's design?
We were deliberately looking for that. That guy you mentioned is called Ian Bogost.
Yeah.
And yeah, that was a pretty famous thing he did. We were looking for precisely that, trying to make this really, really simple and very constrained interactions and see what could come out of them that we were not expecting. It was part of a design decision to do that. And at the time, it was already known that this could happen. People's creativity will find like space through the cracks of the limitations they had. But we didn't try to make them be stupid or anything. We just tried to make them very simple and limited. As interactions, we were still, I mean, the point of all these experiments is to explore user creativity in a way, and what triggers it, and in which ways that can be used to foster conversations that emerge from this creativity. So it was part of the design. That explains more or less? Okay, cool. And you know, just because of that, it makes kind of sense. But I already planned it that way. Let's talk about community a little bit. A user model or any other sense of identity combined with tools for communication between users is probably all we need to experience the emergence of community. During its time, OpenStudio featured a small but vibrant community of around 3,000 active users. And going back to the discussion about like limitations and simplicity and all that, this particular system was actually, it doesn't belong to the same breed as the PictureXS and the Tiny One, because it was actually very rich in features. And even though it had like the very strong limitation of not allowing their users to communicate directly unless they use their own art, there were a lot of tools for them to do that in an expressive way. I mean, you could just, if you want, you could just write in the drawing tool. people would set up art shows and advertise special discount days on their galleries. They were organized enough to vote for features and communicate them to us, the developers. There were art matches where people would throw a piece of art back and forth between each other. The properties of the user model were rich enough to facilitate a space for all these interactions through ad creation, commerce, gallery spaces, etc. Let's see some like interesting, fun examples. This is a hijacked declaration of love. So this user Chia, which I happen to know, and Paul too, they are now married. But she made this declaration of love to Paul, and it happened that someone else bought it before Paul ever saw it, and decided to say no when it was a clear yes. It's just funny. It's a chess game, so somebody draws the board and the pieces and has like a little messaging thing and puts it up for sale. Whoever wants to, with the first move, whoever wants to pick up the match, buys the piece, makes the second move, puts it for sale again. There's a flaw in this system, right? Which is, how can you make sure that your competitor will get the piece from you back, right? Because what ended up happening is like this very strange kind of like financial trolling or something, where like, I would see that after the second move, purchase it because they do it for cheap so they don't spend too much money. I purchase it, and then I know the other guy wants to continue their game, right? So I just put like, I bump up the price, and just, then nobody buys it, and the game's over. This kind of things happened a lot. It's just interesting. People would write instructives, so like how to do things in the system for people that couldn't understand it or whatever. So this one in particular, he's telling you how to put things for sale.
Did anybody buy this one?
I don't remember. I don't remember. It was not that long ago that we did this, but long enough ago that just like every time I search and dig through stuff for these things, like something else comes up that I didn't notice before. Self-promotion, policy voting. So this happened, the idea of the angel investor, this is not artificial intelligence, the idea of the angel investor came through before I got into the lab. And when I got in, there was a full-blown discussion between the developers, which was the members of the team I just joined, and local 00110 pixel pushers union, which is some union that like a group of users put together to suggest features or oppose to features. So at some point, somebody from the team, that I can't remember who it was, suggested to create an angel investor program within the system where like we would track specific users that were producing specific kinds of art, and we would decide that for some reason that we were completely arbitrarily stipulating, this art or their behavior in the system deserved to be sponsored by an angel investor. So we would like throw like big chunks of virtual currency to these users and see what happened. And this was announced in the website's blog, and users didn't like it. So they made this contract and started throwing it around. And I did vote against it. I thought it was very weird. But it just kept going and we never implemented it. It's a good question to ask is like, are these things still pieces of art or not, right? Is the art the whole thing? This is another one. This is kind of, this came from the union as a proposed feature that they thought was fair to users that came up with an original drawing or original content would get a 1% profit every time this drawing was resold. So every time there was a transaction, regardless of like how many transformations were made, the person that saved the first version of the drawing would get a little bit of money. And I don't think it never happened. I don't remember if anybody ever voted. I couldn't find any other version of this thing in the database. And at some point, some users decided they didn't want to be people, they wanted to be art institutions. So, for example, this guy, Daniel King, he came up with this social contract to behave like a museum instead of an artist. Because there was this thing where like you were an artist, but you also had your gallery and you could sell people that you bought from other people, art that you bought from other people, so you would be also like, art dealer as much as an artist and the gallery and like whatnot. So like I guess there was probably the need to like narrow the behavioral space of the user to something that probably mirrored the real world a little more or something than the system did. And so this guy created his museum. It behaved like a museum and it was fine. Then we got like a trend for making museums, and people would get the contract and just duplicate it, change the name, change the signature, it's completely valid too, and then you got another museum. Started to be museum competition, things like that. This is, art show flyer. This artist commissioned a bunch of other artists with the bloody theme specifically attached to the commissions, and then made a show where she sold all this art that these people made for her and that she paid for. So it's kind of like the entrepreneurial artist curator thing. And of course, there was just like tons and tons and tons of art. The tiny icon factory is on the opposite end of this spectrum. Even though it is a fertile content creation machine, it's the only one of these systems that's still alive. And the reason why this can happen is because it's so simple in design that it's reflected through the implementation, and it has very easy for us to just keep it alive and maintain and not make it impact other aspects of our postgraduate student life. But it has no social features to sustain a sense of identity. Thus, nobody knows who they are talking to, and the foundation for a community can't be laid out. In any case, there is something else that I've always wanted to explore, which is direct contact with pre-existing communities. I wanted to meet with a community and learn from their needs, to provide them with a system that could help them creatively communicate with each other. For this, a degree of fieldwork, amateur ethnography and whatnot, was going to be required. That's a lot of talking. A few years ago, I stumbled upon this book called The Be Kind Rewind Protocol, written by Michel Gondry, the filmmaker most famously known for The Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind. This book describes how to set up an art show workshop where visitors are grouped together as teams and guided through a labyrinth of sets with the necessary guidance and equipment to make a short amateur movie in just a couple of hours. The experience will end in a small theater where the participants will watch the movie they just made. And the cover of the book reflects that moment. Some of them were technicians, some of them were actors. This project doesn't rely on computers or digital communication systems, but I like to think it is digital in spirit. And I believe that this kind of directed agency is a great way to inspire members of a given community to engage in a conversation by creating cultural content. Let's look at a project I made called Honey, I Shrunk Red Hook, which could be labeled as collaborative public action and installation. This is from 2009. Red Hook is an interesting neighborhood in Brooklyn, New York City. A street called Richards splits it in two. Southeast of it, we have projects, housing projects, and 99-cent stores inhabited mostly by an African-American and Caribbean population. And on the other side, we have hipsters, artists, and all what comes with them in the New York City environment. Both communities live their lives politely ignoring each other. When my friend opened a gallery right here, I found it to be an excellent opportunity to test some ideas about community and participation. The goal being to have these communities interact and communicate through art. After some deliberation with my collaborator, Andy Cavatorta, we decided to set up the following program. We would make a scale model of the neighborhood section around the gallery and put it inside the gallery. Then we would figure out a cheap way to make dolls out of photographs, which we did with a laser printer, a laser cutter, a lot of Elmer glue, and many hours. Then we walked around the neighborhood asking people if we could take their picture. And then we, while we were doing this, taking this picture, we would explain them that their doll will be made and that they could go play with it in the model a couple of weeks later when the gallery was open with the finished thing. We also launched an online program asking for non-Red Hook residents to submit their pictures so that we could have tourists to play with. Yeah. So here you can see this is the one of the corners of the gallery, and you can see here is this model that is actually a direct scale representation of the building across the street. Here, that's me taking the back picture part of what was going to become the dolls that represented these two guys here. People just love this thing. Here they are featured inside the installation with all the other people. This is the local BMX bike gang, which I bet you would have never ever gone inside an art gallery if it was not because of this. And there they are, inside the gallery. They are the art, right? There's this thing that they become part of the piece of art, which is, I believe, very empowering. Another resident with her dog. We made a bunch of images based on real landmarks of the neighborhood, just to kind of like create that atmosphere that they were in a cartoon reality of their own lives. Here's the laser cutter in action, working through the gallery's assistant. That's her with her doll and her hammer, ready to like put everything together. This is the simple online brochure. It was a very simple thing that we would just send to people, and then we would get the pictures, and we made a bunch of them. After collecting around 100 dolls, we enjoyed a few weekends where we succeeded at bringing people into the gallery that had never visited an art gallery to talk about art with people that do it every weekend. So there's a good collection of them. Any questions about this one? Yeah?
What's going on in the top left corner? Is he wearing mats?
Yeah, that's a Mexican wrestler. He made that. He was like, I want to be that. It's one of the tourists.
It's a tourist.
Yeah. So like, from all these people, can you tell who doesn't belong to Red Hook?
The corner plate? Really famous person?
Yeah. And the wrestler.
Is there anyone else?
There is, this guy is from Mexico City. And this lady here, Andres must know, because she is the maintenance lady at the media lab, Peggy. She also sent the picture. It was pretty cool, like, you know. Okay, anything else anybody would like to add? Ask or something? Okay, let's move on to the next one.
Okay. Did you have anyone say they didn't want their picture taken?
People were extremely friendly in that neighborhood. And I think we probably got a couple of persons that said no, but I can't even remember that. People would just say, okay. It was really funny. There was like, we encountered some situations that were kind of like hostile, but not to us. Like, we took a, sometimes there would be cases where like people would become doll groups, like we decided to keep them together if their arms overlapped or whatever. And there was these three people, which was like a pregnant girl and two dudes. One of them was her little brother, and the other one was her, what I learned after was her, like, I should use an appropriate word, right? We're on camera. Well, he was like not such a good boyfriend. And we learned about that later. We took the picture perfect. And then we met the kid later on. The baby was already born, and like the girl was crying. And it was just like they never made it to the gallery because they were too busy having this kind of like crazy tragedy at home. So there were some of those. But like people were very friendly, extremely.
Did you end up making cutouts of the people who didn't want their picture taken?
No, because like, if they didn't want their picture taken, we couldn't take it, so it wouldn't have even happened.
Yeah, I was just wondering if you represented them in like a form of,
like,
you know,
having like,
I don't know, they exist somewhere out there, but just so
we didn't
blank.
Even think
okay.
about that.
I don't know, yeah.
Yeah. We were like, okay, they don't want to, like, it's okay, they won't get it. But it's interesting, though. It's an interesting idea. Like going more into the kind of, like, societal aspect of the interaction, like, what happened there? Because this is more, like, already all the way onto this side, right? There's not much we can know about them by this. It was just about bringing them together.
Yeah.
And that was the main goal, to, like, bring all the people that were not into the arts in there. There were children. Children loved it. It was pretty cool.
Did anyone take theirs after?
Everybody did.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Everybody
so.
Did.
Cool.
That was part of the thing. The final day of the exhibition was like a party, and we actually destroyed the town and gave them their things. Yeah, they were like, okay. Some pleasure out of that they got. Okay. How are we doing on time? Are we doing okay?
10 minutes.
And that's it?
Well, for questions also.
Ah, okay. So, because, yeah, I have only one project left, and it's actually pretty short. So this is, label it remotely connected interactive public performance, whatever. In 2012, an experimental theatrical performance artist called Constanza Macras contacted me to collaborate with her on a piece in the forest on North Wales. She wanted something digital to be part of her performance piece without really knowing much about what she meant by that. After going over pretty much everything I've said here, and a lot more, of course, we agreed to design some kind of feedback communication system between the performance in the forest and the remote audience back in the city of Cardiff. So this is a kind of like map of the lower part of Great Britain. And here is Cardiff, which is the capital city of Wales. And in the northernmost part of Wales, like this is actually, this park is kind of like, you drive 10 miles to the east and you're not in Wales anymore. It's kind of like in the border. There's actually, it's called Wapri Park. There's actually a castle there, which is kind of like where the Welsh finally lost against the English and they kind of took over them. And this performance was happening through the forest, and it was this kind of like theater thing with contemporary dance and all that. And there was a live audience there that would follow the performance to the woods, and that was kind of like the core of the show. But Constanza wanted to add something extra, trying to connect it to this this area of downtown Cardiff, and you will see why that makes sense in a second. Let me give you a bit more of a backstory about why this connection, right? Because out of the blue, it just doesn't make any sense. So the community we wanted to engage with. For some reason, every Friday night, people in Cardiff dress up as pop culture icons and walk around that area I just showed you, which is the club zone in downtown Cardiff, getting wasted. And by that, I mean like really wasted. Like if you go to this Flickr set here, this guy is a pretty good journalist, photographer, and he has like a huge collection of what happens through this night. Some of these pictures are just like beautiful. Like there's one of my favorite ones, it's kind of like, it's like a long shot of a back alley, and there's light from like the other end, and there's like debris and like party debris, you know, like chips and red cups and whatever. And like Superman is just walking away like really tired like this. And it's just a beautiful scene. So like that's what these nights are about. And Constanza was actually like her theater piece before it became like a combination of theater and like whatever digital was about this in a way. And she wanted to take one of these characters, we settled for a Smurf, and transport him to the forest where he would experience a fairy tale dream-like journey through the woods. And she wanted the people getting drunk in Cardiff, these guys here and like all the other people with them, to be able to witness and even somehow interact or even affect the hero's adventure in the forest. So we came up with a pretty crazy rig where we were filming people in the streets and broadcasting to televisions in the forest and transmitting the action in the forest back to the big screen, back to a big screen in the street. Passersby could also SMS to a special number, and their text would appear not just on screen, on that screen in the street, but it would also be received by a cell phone carrying actor that would respond to their messages with action. And here is we are in the street taking video. There was a lot of kind of like, not everything we did here for budgetary reasons was automated or whatever. So it was kind of like we would take the video and like then quickly composite it and then broadcast it. So there was a delay. But the people were there all night, so we thought we could get away with that. So like we're filming this girl here, and bad girl, and she will be wandering around those streets for a while, and then maybe 20 minutes later, she will see herself in a television screen in the forest, interacting as part of the environment that is surrounding these actors in the forest. So that's kind of like a couple of scenes where like the televisions were put. Here's the Smurf. The Smurf, even though it was a guy Smurf, it was performed by both males and females. So this is people that were in the street like that. We had like a black mat around their heads. So we were only transmitting their heads, and they were just talking. And we did a slow motion pass on them. So they just, it's like they were like this, kind of like the Cheshire Cat from Alice in Wonderland figure. They would be in these moments of the story when the Smurf would have to like make a decision or change the route or something. And this is the screen in Cardiff with some SMS that somebody wrote. Anything to ask or say about this one? It's pretty weird. I'm I don't mind if you have questions.
Did you see people exploit the? I mean, you talked earlier about how when you have an anonymous forum, that people tend to turn into a bathroom wall. Did you see that at all in this poll?
Yeah, but in this case, I'm glad you mentioned that because I completely forgot about it. Because in this case, this was a BBC production, and like all the data was fed into a website they have called The Space, where like everything was going to be collected and tweeted about and all that stuff. So we actually had to have like a filter channel where like everything that was not appropriate enough was just discarded in real time. We had somebody monitoring all the SMS. So that way it didn't happen. And you know, it was anonymous, but not really, because like we recorded your phone number. So. But it doesn't matter. I mean, it's harmless, so I guess it doesn't matter. Yeah. Anything else? I'm sure I like missed to mention a lot of stuff about this one. It was really fast. Okay, well, let's move on then. I feel these have all been great experiments in form, proofs of concept even, if you will. In a sense, I feel we're going through a phase similar to that period in the late 19th and early 20th centuries when people like Edward Muybridge or Etienne Marais or Winsor McCay or the Lumiere brothers or Marcel Duchamp even were experimenting with ideas and techniques that were to shape the moving picture as a viable communication medium in their futures. You know, when, I mean, we are surrounded by moving pictures now, but at some point this was something that nobody else had made before. That's Muybridge's studies of the horse in motion. This Etienne Marais and his chronophotographic gun. I don't know if any of you knew about this invention. That is really awesome. Like, of course, I bet you some like user experience product designers told him you have to not have it look like a gun if you want to make this into something that will be, you know, absorbed by people. So this gun basically goes and like shoots up. It's basically, I don't know why he made it like a gun, but it basically shoots like a multiple exposure thing on the same negative. And he took pictures like that around 60 years before Doc Edgerton started making. Because, you know, later on, the strobe light was invented, and then you would just like shoot once, and then the strobe light would take care of like giving you this effect. But at this time, that was not available. The Lumiere brothers and the first movie camera, of course. Marcel Duchamp's, this is a purely conceptual exploration he made in 1912 about like multiple exposure, you could say. And then this is a photograph that somebody else made 50 years later using a strobe light. And this is the first cartoon in history, Gertie the Dinosaur by Winsor McCay. When I put all these examples next to Stanley Kubrick movie, for example, or when I think about film and television as a whole, I can see an evolution of a medium that has gone from discovery to maturity. And I can't help but wonder where all these digital experiments will take us. We see them all around us, this like interactive network communication created systems just are bubbling up everywhere, right? I mean, like something like Twitter even is one of those, right? They are just everywhere. And there's too many of them, and we're kind of like coming up with sort of like way of understanding what these things are and how we can use them to create meaningful content, I guess. We're shaping a brand new breed of cultural atoms this way, and what kind of matter will they make? To find an answer to these questions, there lies my challenge. Thank you. Here's some information if anybody is interested. And then now let's just chat. It's your turn.
See if anybody has comments or questions. All of these are active or on
some? Yeah, all these works.
Mm-hmm. What do you think about like the new social networks that have more like Instagram that has effects and Vine that have more like artistic sort of tools rather than just communication like Facebook?
I think that's very nice. You know, it's funny that you mentioned them because they are actually a lot more limited systems in their design than other systems that are not targeting creativity, right? Like Vine is extremely simple. It just the limitations it forces you to assume are great. It's just a 6 or 8 second loop, and that's all you have, right? And a little square, and that's all. But I, for example, I think they did a really great job with the user interface of making the video, where like it's just tapping the actual video and there's no controls. I kind of thought that's a very interesting way to go to think about like how can you make the medium itself be its own interface, right? As opposed to having like, because most of our controls are legacy from buttons and levers, are things that come from machines that are in the real world. And of course, we're going to be able to empathize with that and use it. But the option of exploring what could things be if we discard that as a base design, as a legacy, is very interesting. So I appreciate that about Vine. Instagram is also very simple. And at least originally, it was very constrained the same way, right? It's like take a picture, put the filter, upload. One thing that everybody thinks about, like, everybody asks the question of why Instagram became Instagram, right? Because there were, like, a number of other systems prior to it that were almost Instagram, but not. And they would do the same things, but they had, like, little things like, I don't know if anybody ever used PicPlease. PicPlease was just like Instagram, except they made the mistake of letting you upload high-resolution pictures. So they would take the picture at the original resolution that the cell phone took, and you would upload that. So like half of the times or more, the upload would fail because the network connectivity was bad. So that kind of like stopped it from like being so popular, I guess. I don't know. Is that more or less goes in the direction you would?
Yeah.
Okay.
How much thought do you give to the types of creativity that are unleashed around these different experiments as opposed to just within the experiments?
Does
that make sense? So people interact with these systems and they express themselves creatively into the system. And I think there's also a way to think about the creativity that's inspired by that system, but which isn't actually captured within it. Do you ever think about that when you're coming up with these things?
Yeah, that's the whole meta thing, which is actually, you know, like, I can't really like go and touch all these aspects of this discussion because it'll just become like a semester-long grad course or something. That's the subject of a completely different talk that I could give. If you're interested in that kind of stuff, there's a lot of stuff both in research and resources and my own take on what that could be from back then, 4 or 5 years ago, is written in my thesis here. It's my thesis project was actually about thinking about the artist, the art object, the studio, and the audience as a combined system where like they all become the object. And what happens when you do that?
Where is the art?
Pretty much, right? Because it's hard to tell. Like, in the OpenStudio system, all those drawings, if you ask an art person if those are art, they would say no. But they might end up deciding that the actual system as a whole is art, right? So the creative process of like, I guess it is a tricky question. It's a difficult one, but I definitely think about that a lot. And without reaching any conclusions, there's a lot I wrote about that in there, if you're interested. It's not very dense. The English is funny.
Well, it's 2:46, so if you want to talk to Luis, he's going to be hanging out for a while. Thank you.